Good.
The president wants to spy on 200 million Americans without a warrant. Has he read this document, which he was sworn to uphold?
Now, I will not have you libel Abraham Lincoln.
I don't understand the problem with registering guns. We register cars. Every nation has the right to self-defense under the United Nations Charter. Why shouldn't Israel exercise it?
Meet Mark Levine.
Good evening, America. Welcome to the Inside Scoop. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. So begins Charles Dickens' A Tale of Two Cities. So will historians write about November 2008. In some ways, it was the worst of times. America has the lowest approval rating of the direction this country is going since any time in recorded polling. In fact, some put it in single digits, 9%, 7%, 5% think the country's going in the right direction. The current president of the United States, George W. Bush, has the highest disapproval rating in all of polling history. And yet, it seems there's never been as much hope or optimism, all caused by the election of 2008. Polls also show that 67% of Americans are proud of their country, 59% are excited about an Obama presidency, and a mere 27% are afraid, despite all the effort that John McCain and Sarah Palin made into making people afraid of Barack Obama. Yes, this will be an election for the history books, and not only because of the obvious reason, the first African-American president, a president whose name, Barack Hussein Obama, sounds nothing like those Anglo-Saxon white guys who preceded him. Obviously, it's the culmination of 50 years of hard work. It's hard to imagine that 50 years ago, America was still a Jim Crow nation. Blacks still couldn't vote, and now we have an African-American president. But also on a political scale, it was a landslide victory. Barack Obama got 53%, the highest percentage that any Democrat has gotten since Lyndon Johnson. And indeed, if you look at first-term presidents, perhaps the best election showing since Franklin Roosevelt in 1932. Indeed, many are comparing this election to 1932, and not only because we have the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression, but as America throwing out the bad, throwing in the good, making radical change. Or is it that radical? What will Obama do? He says he's going to move to the middle. He says he's going to act in a bipartisan fashion, and indeed many Republicans voted for Obama. What will the Republicans do? Will they turn to Sarah Palin's style, a social conservatism, or will it be more of the economic conservatives who seem to have not done so well, at least not according to America's current economy? There are many questions to ask about what's next, and to answer those questions, particularly about what the Republicans are going to do, I've invited Republican strategist Mike Lane, not only to gloat, but to find out the direction of his party. Mike Lane, welcome to the Inside Scoop.
Mark, it's a pleasure to be back. I'm not sure why I came tonight, but I look forward to... Let me say, never before have I heard in the monologue so many misstatements and fabrications, but we'll go through them one by one and we'll get to
it. You can go through them now if you want to.
Right, well, I mean, two things that stand out. Number one, 67% of America now proud of its country. I suppose we're finally including Michelle Obama in that. She's finally gotten to the point where she can be proud of her country. I'm proud that she's finally proud of her country.
Already and, attacking. He hasn't even been inaugurated.
Not anywhere near as bad as Barack Obama attacked Republicans. Let's get into it. Come on, what do you got on your mind?
Barack Obama attacking Republicans.
Absolutely.
I actually felt that both Barack Obama and John McCain, to his credit, were reaching out across the aisle. I felt both of them were trying very hard to bind this country together after what was, after all, a fairly ugly campaign. I have to say I was very proud of John McCain. He seemed like the John McCain I used to know in 2000, prior to, I don't know, the Karl Rove alien inhabiting his body and causing him to do all kinds of things. He seems to have coming back to the respectful John McCain. Obama very clearly reached out across the aisle when he was elected and made very clear that all American perspectives would be taken part. I'm very proud of both men.
Okay.
Even George Bush seemed to be acting in a bipartisan fashion this week.
Let's take his press conference. Is a gratuitous partisan slam against a first lady revered in America really the way to reach
partisan
across the
slam.
Aisle? A gratuitous partisan slam.
What did Obama say?
We all know the only seances that ever went on in the White House.
Why don't you tell our listeners what Obama said first?
All right. Obama, he said, I've talked to all the past presidents. Well, no, I've talked to the living past presidents. I don't want to get involved in any Nancy Reagan seances here at the White House, when in fact we know that the only seances that ever went on at the White House were between Hillary Clinton and Eleanor Roosevelt. There were no seances.
There were
some unfounded, unconfirmed accusations Nancy Reagan consulted an astrologer.
That's been confirmed.
But the only seances that ever went on were between Hillary Clinton and Eleanor Roosevelt. Now, why is Barack Obama, Ronald Reagan, the most revered president this nation has ever had, being, you know, his surviving widow, being partisanly and gratuitously slammed by Barack in his first press conference, and this is reaching across the aisle trying to be nice? Mark, please, this guy is on a mission, and his mission is as partisan as it gets.
You know, that's amazing to me, Mike. I actually thought you were going to be all magnanimous.
If Obama would be magnanimous, I would be magnanimous.
You know, I mean, he was saying he talked to all the living presidents. Well, not the ones that are dead. You know, Nancy Reagan did consult astrologers in order to determine.
Unconfirmed reports from Reagan, never confirmed by the White House.
Donald
Reagan, never confirmed by the White House.
Who?
He was Secretary of the Treasury.
Under
Ronald Reagan.
Right. He was a Republican secretary.
And what was,
who said that his appointments were dictated by Nancy Reagan's astrology
clock.
I don't have to go into all of this. Obviously was something very silly.
Donald Reagan, a guy who was fired and had an axe to grind.
Extremely silly that the President of the United States would allow his wife's astrology charts to determine anything. The point is,
Which never happened. And Barack Obama
said, how do you know it never happened?
We're not going to have a White House like Nancy Reagan.
Were you there? No.
No.
Was Donald Reagan there?
No.
Yes.
No.
Has Nancy Reagan denied it occurred? No. Okay. So the point was, yes, it was gratuitous. He apologized for it. He was making a little joke. That's not the point.
You don't joke about former first ladies. Do we tell jokes about Eleanor Roosevelt? Do we tell jokes about...
oh, my God. Rush Limbaugh called Hillary Clinton a feminazi.
She's never been first lady. She has never been first lady.
Hillary Clinton? Yes, she was
first
lady.
That's right. She was first lady, wasn't she? All right.
She's never been first lady.
I forgot about that.
Oh my God. It wasn't that long ago.
She was so ineffectual. I forgot about that.
She's never been first lady. Is that like rewriting the history about Nancy Reagan's astrology? Hillary Clinton's never been first lady. You know, even Rush Limbaugh supporters aren't going to buy that one. But you know who might? Sarah Palin. She believes all kinds of things.
After she blew the health care thing, I totally lost track of her. But you're right. It was a momentary mental lapse here. I apologize to Hillary Clinton, unlike Barack Obama.
Barack Obama has apologized first come by Nancy Reagan. So there you go. They both apologized. I think the thing.
Why did he say it in the first place?
It was an offhand comment. It's the kind of thing that you or I say, you know?
No,
he talked to all the living presidents, but he didn't talk to the dead ones. He didn't have any Nancy Reagan seances.
When you and I are trying to score political points, we make comments like that. When you're president-elect of the United States and you're trying to bring the country
together. He wasn't trying to score political points.
Yes, he was.
Who would he score political points with?
With the rabid Democratic left.
Oh, that's
that
silly.
That wants to slam Nancy
Reagan.
That's
silly. If anything, Obama, I thought, from election night to his press conference, has been extraordinarily reaching out. There's some talk of maybe him having
some Republicans talk about some more stuff in
his government.
All right. Let's
go back to the significance of the 2008 elections. I mean, this is one for the history books.
It's one for the history books. It's a great thing for America that we have an African-American president. When you started in your monologue that who would have thought this 50 years ago, I would have thought this 50 years ago. It is not a surprise to me that we've elected a black man to the presidency of the United States. I always thought that it would be a Republican black man that was elected before a Democrat one was, because Barack
Democratic.
Obama... Democratic.
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 I know you Republicans have a hard time with that word.
Whatever. Democratic Party, whatever you want to call it, Mark. The point is, Republicans, I always thought, would have a more inclusive message. Barack Obama's message is divisive. He will divide America by a lot of different things.
It's amazing to me that the attack is beginning. See, here's something that really surprises me, Mike. You know, here it is after the election, and of course, all these attacks didn't work. Only 27% of Americans are afraid. Most are excited, including McCain voters. Many of them are excited.
I don't know what
you
polls
find
are
Republican
what
voters.
What poll are you looking at? Because that's not the polling information.
59% of Americans are excited.
Excited. So, that's the word they
use. That's the word they use in the poll.
Well,
and only 53% of Americans voted for
him. I would be so in that 59% because I'm excited about opposing Barack Obama's vision for America. Because I don't want us divided the way he wants to divide us by class. I don't want us divided the way he wants.
You know, it's shocking to me. Here, there's an entire election where the Republicans are saying he's a socialist, he's a Marxist, he's a terrorist.
Well, he's
evil. He's a terrorist.
No, he's a Marxist.
He's a Marxist.
He's a socialist.
You're going to insist that Barack Obama's a Marxist.
What is division of wealth? Let me quote
Mike, have you been drinking with Sarah Palin?
Each according to their needs. Now, if that isn't Karl Marx at his most quotable, what is it?
Mike, the election's over. These silly attacks didn't work, and they're not going to work now.
We'll see.
Is that what the Republican Party is going to be? The party of no. It they continue to be the party of no ideas. No.
Here's,
the party
here's
of Barack Obama's a Marxist. Is that really all the Republican Party stands for?
Here's what
negative
it is.
Attacks and calling ridiculous names.
If Barack Obama stands up to his partial rhetoric about reaching across the aisle, about doing things with Republicans,
he's always said that
about
rhetoric.
Being everybody's president, then he'll do quite well. If he governs from the left the way I expect him to, instead of governing from the center, then yes, we will be the party of the cheerful opposition, and we will stand there and we will say, no, Mr. President, you cannot take this path, this country down the path of Sweden or Finland or anything like that. We're not going to let it happen.
I love these amazing things. He's a Marxist, he's a terrorist, Sweden,
never
Finland.
Said he was a terrorist. Never said he was a terrorist.
No. Palin said he was palling around with terrorists.
Well, he was.
Apparently him and William Ayers used to go to Disneyland together.
No, board meetings together.
Really?
Mark, let me ask you this.
They piled around. I can't believe you're going here. I have to say, Mike, I'm surprised.
No.
I'm surprised. I thought that these kind of vicious, unfounded, ridiculous attacks would end at the election. I thought
spreading the wealth is not a vicious, unfounded
even
attack.
Even John McCain, even George Bush are talking about the future, how to work together.
Yes, they are.
Seems to me that you're representing a wing of the Republican Party that insists on trying to tear this man down, even though he hasn't even been inaugurated as president yet. And I have to tell you something, that strategy is going to fail.
Let's look at
because Americans don't want to hear, when I said the best of times, the worst of times, Americans think the worst of times is under your president, George W. Bush, the Republican way, the massive financial crisis, two wars that seem without end, massive deficits like we've never seen before, massive corruption, going on and on and on and on. It's not just that they put Barack Obama in. The Democrats got 5, 6, maybe 7 seats in the Senate. It all depends on Alaska and Minnesota. The House has the highest number of Democrats. Republicans have never had this high number, I think, since the 20s. The American people have made a choice. They have decided that your party failed them and that my party should run the country. And what's fascinating to me is instead of you saying, we wish the man well, we hope he succeeds, we hope we can work together and get rid of some of these bad policies, you're going to go on and call him names.
No.
I don't think that's what Americans want.
I
but if you want to do that, we'll do even better in 2010 and 2012.
I do wish him well. I do hope we can work together. I have my doubts. What has he done since he was elected? He's made one major decision, and one decision only.
He chose a terrific chief of staff.
He has chose Rahm Emanuel as the chief of staff.
Great choice.
Rahm Emanuel, whose total career is dedicated to partisan whipping of Democrats into shape, keeping Democrats in line.
Did you forget his work in the Clinton White House? Rahm Emanuel is known as a very good manager. He's a perfect chief of staff.
But he has no relationship with any Republicans. He doesn't need them.
He's a chief of staff. He'll
set the tone for the administration.
No, Obama will set the tone for the administration.
He has chosen
Rahm
man
Emanuel
as his chief of staff.
Is a tactician and quite a good one.
And his tactician is steamroll the Republicans. That's what Rahm Emanuel has steamrolled Republicans.
Rahm Emanuel has served two roles. One, he worked in the Clinton White House. Secondly, he worked to elect Democrats as number four, just like the head of the Republican Congressional Committee.
It's not just as head of the Congressional
Committee. It's the role
of
number four to try to elect Democrats.
I don't begrudge him.
Here's the thing. I got to tell you something. I think Rahm Emanuel will be perfect because I think Obama's such a good cop. He needs a bit of a bad cop. He needs someone who can tell it like it is and who can make things work. He won't be the face of the administration at all. Obama will be the face, and he's already been shot for Republicans.
He's the insider dealing with Congress, and Republicans will not work with him because he won't work with them.
When we come back, we'll hear whether Mike really thinks all these attacks are justified. We'll also hear from you. 888-488-MARK, 888-488-6275. Let us know what you think. Be right back.
This year, 28,000 Americans will be diagnosed with oral cancer. Every year, 7,000 Americans die of oral cancer.
Cohen, and I'm an oral cancer survivor. I didn't fit the profile. I didn't smoke or drink. I had no family history of cancer. No family history of cancer. I was 31 years old. 31 years old. I went to see my dentist about a sore in my mouth that wouldn't heal. It was oral cancer. I had to have a radical neck dissection and a portion of my tongue reconstructed. I didn't know if I was going to live or die.
I'm Surgeon General Richard Carmona. The survival rate for oral cancer is only 50%. Oral cancer can happen to anyone. If you have a sore or lesion in your mouth that doesn't heal within 2 weeks, see your dentist. Early detection is the key.
Early detection saves lives. I know.
One in eight Americans goes hungry. One idea helped change that. A community started a garden that blossomed into farmers markets. One in six children lives in poverty. One group of women found an answer by opening a daycare center that their neighbors could afford. Today, 36 million Americans live in poverty. But one by one, people are helping themselves and each other to change the picture of poverty to one of hope. For easy ways you can help, visit povertyusa.org.
Two words for you. Pop quiz. Ready? Name any funny movie. A drama. Name a mystery. And one more thing. Name the movie your kids saw today in science class.
Know what really matters. Know about your kid's school. And know about your kid. Find out 100 ways to know more, do more.
Here again, the Inside Scoop with Mark Levine.
Welcome back to the Inside Scoop. If you want to call in, the toll-free number is 888-488-MARK, 888-488-6275. I've invited Mike Lane in, Republican strategist. I'm not sure why. I mean, I thought we were going to have a calm, relaxed conversation about the future of America. Maybe I've just been living in this wonderful blue bubble that is currently for the state of Virginia and D.C. and Maryland and North Carolina and a bunch of other states. And most people I talk to are very excited by the prospect. Even some McCain voters I've talked to are willing to give Barack Obama a chance. They're excited about his being president, and they think they want to see where he goes before they criticize him. But Mike, it seems like you're not in that category. You're tearing the guy down before he's even been inaugurated. And I got to say, I'm surprised.
No, Mark.
I thought you'd give this guy more of a chance.
I'm not tearing it down. I will admit flat out, I do not trust him. I don't like where I think he's going to take the country, but let's talk about his rhetoric and where he's going now.
Let me suggest to you where he's going to take the country.
He's going to
take his country where he said he would take the country in his campaign.
I hope not. If he changes now,
and that would be fair, because the American people voted on what he said in the campaign.
Right.
They voted by a quite strong majority, 53-46%, that this is the path they wanted the country to go. If he deviates from his campaign rhetoric, then let me suggest to you that would be wrong. In whatever direction, whether to the center or to the left from it. He told America what he would do. They voted on him. Sounds to me like you just don't respect the opinion of the American people.
First of all, 52-47, not 53-46.
52-47. According to CNN, 53-46. I looked it up before we came on here.
CNN. Okay, give me a break. Now,
you can take the numbers. I can do the math.
Right, let's talk about the leftist campaign that Obama ran and his centrist rhetoric, almost conservative rhetoric that he's been talking about for the last couple weeks, including the last couple weeks of the campaign. If, as Chief of Staff designee Rahm Emanuel said yesterday on George Stephanopoulos, and the centerpiece of the Obama economic plan is going to shift from increasing taxes on the economy and particularly on the rich, and instead making it overall a plan that will deliver tax relief to the economy, particularly to the middle class, and forego the tax increase on the upper classes, I think that is something Republicans will support, and the president will be off to a wonderful start.
The president would be idiotic if he decided to break his campaign promises 2 weeks into the presidency. He would lose respect among Democrats, independents, and even some Republicans. You know, it seems
to me, Rahm Emanuel was on George Stephanopoulos yesterday. He was asked point blank four times, is the tax increase on the wealthiest Americans
still going to be
part of the economic package, and Rahm Emanuel refused to say yes four times.
Well, that's right, because first of all, there's the surplus package. It's not going to be part of there. That's in the lame duck Congress. It may not happen in the first month or two of the Obama presidency.
Will it happen in the tax package? Will it be part of the overall tax package?
It can
package?
Be part of this one. It can be part of the next one. Look.
Okay.
In other words,
he's backing off because the centerpiece, Mark, in the campaign was the tax increase on the wealthy. Now the centerpiece on the campaign is suddenly tax relief to the middle class.
It's amazing to me. If Barack Obama had said in the campaign that he was going to do tax relief on the middle class first, okay?
He didn't say that in the campaign.
I'm telling you, if he had said that, and if he had said that, and he had not mentioned that we're going to raise taxes on the rich. He just didn't say it.
It was all over his website. I read it. You know, I have it saved.
Stick with me here. Hypothetically, if Obama had run a different campaign, where he didn't tell people what he was going to do, where he said, I'm going to cut taxes if you earn under $250,000, and as to those over $250,000, he didn't say, or he said he wouldn't raise taxes on them. Okay, and then he decided to raise taxes on them, the Republicans would have a holy fit. Saying you're going to raise taxes on the rich does not win anybody votes. In fact, it was a very brave move of him. He had to do it because we have the most massive deficit in American history. George Bush doubled the deficit. So we need to pay that money back somehow. He didn't do it to win votes. What he's doing, amazing to me, is that he took a position that would not win him votes, that would lose him votes. He still became president of the United States. Right now, we have an incredible economic crisis. In an economic crisis, what you do is you cut taxes to help the stimulus. That makes sense. Now, it may be that he cuts taxes for those under $250,000 now and raises it for all those over $250,000 6 months from now. Who knows? It doesn't matter. I fully expect Barack Obama to keep his campaign promises. And if he doesn't, to me, it would be a lot like George Bush, the first George Bush, George Bush Sr., who said, read my lips, no new taxes, broke his campaign promise, and the Democrats didn't like him for it, even though he did things the Democrats felt he should do. The Republicans didn't like him for it. He deserted his promise, and lo and behold, he lost to Clinton in 92. Barack Obama dare not fall into that same trap. He will do what he said he was elected to do.
All I can say is, not only was it Rahm Emanuel, the chief of staff designee, who yesterday four times...
It's not his decision.
Four times, he's speaking for the president-elect when he's on that show.
Obviously, they haven't made up their mind yet.
Not only did he refuse to confirm it, but in the press conference on Friday, the president-elect, Obama, was asked the exact same question.
And he said, we'll see about economic times.
And he wouldn't confirm it either.
And that's smart.
So.
Because it depends
Mark,
on where
it was
our
a campaign promise,
is.
Right. But he didn't say that in the campaign.
He didn't say he would do it in the first 100 days. He's going to do it. I guarantee he'll do it.
He played class warfare, which is always a winning economic thing in the campaign.
Promising to raise taxes is never a winning economic thing.
After he played class warfare all throughout the campaign. Yes.
Hold on. Is it class warfare?
Yes, it is.
It's class warfare to say you're going to soak the rich and redistribute it to the poor. Mike.
He's going to redistribute the richest money, accumulated wealth to the poor.
Did George Bush and John McCain play class warfare when they decided to soak the poor and help the rich? Is that class warfare or not? Is it only class warfare if you want to redistribute the tax burden from the middle class to more wealthy people who used to have the higher tax burden?
Under George Bush, the bottom 40% of wage earners in the United States paid zero taxes.
Under George Bush,
zero taxes.
The top 1% of Americans own more wealth than the bottom 90% put together.
The top 1% of wage earners in the United States paid 82% of the taxes in America.
I could just see you in revolutionary France. You'd be like Louis XIV, and you'd say, you know, the king is financing most of the wars. These peasants, the ones that are eating out of garbage cans, they hardly finance our wars at all. Why does Louis XIV have to pay for all the wars? We had to give up 3 golden toilet seats just to pay for our war. Mike, when you have 1% of the country that has more wealth than the bottom
92% of the taxes,
when you have more unequal income distribution in America than at any time since 1928,
those are specious
before
figures. They don't have that kind of wealth.
Great Depression, they do.
No, they don't.
They do. You also have a middle class under every president before this one earned more. The median American family did better under every American president from Roosevelt to today. except for George W. Bush. And now, when you say, well, wait a minute, maybe we should, we've gone a little too far. Maybe 1928 was not a good year for class, for rich being rich and poor being poor. It was right before the Great Depression. Maybe we need to turn back the tide a little. Republicans scream class warfare. Why is it class warfare to suggest that you go back to the Clinton era of taxation when the rich paid a little bit more and the middle class paid a little bit less? Why is this class warfare? All he's doing is saying, let's redistribute the tax burden.
Why can't everyone pay
less? For working people.
Why can't everyone pay less?
Because we have a massive deficit caused by your president.
So let's cut spending then. Let's cut spending.
What?
All right.
The voters rejected this.
To say,
Mike.
Mark,
the voters rejected
it. I'm not.
If the Republican Party is going to continue on the George Bush, John McCain platform, you're going to lose more seats in 2010. You're going to lose more seats in 2012.
I'm not going to argue with you that the voters have directly or indirectly.
They have rejected this philosophy.
Directly or indirectly, they have endorsed the Obama program.
That's correct.
I will argue that 90% of Obama supporters were not intimately familiar with all his programs, all his policies.
All of them?
And when they see
Are voters ever familiar with all of them?
When they see them one by one, they will gravitate back to the Republican Party as they see the Republicans opposing the overreach and excesses of the Barack Obama administration. Now, we'll talk about this
I predict this.
I hope
that the Republican Party continues to take the views that you're taking, because then in 2010 and 2012, we're going to increase Democratic majorities and have a filibuster.
And I hope that Barack Obama overreaches with his congressional liberal colleagues, and we're going to take the White House back in 2012.
George from Fairfax, welcome to the show.
Yeah, I've got a question, or maybe a request really for your guest, Mike, there. It seems like I'm thinking there's an awful lot of your viewers want the phone number for his supplier, because that world that he's living in is a fantasy world. And it's a sad argument when you bring up things like this guy Ayers in a previous show I saw you on. When they bring up things like hanging chads, you've got a piece of paper just barely hanging on, and you cannot determine who that vote was for, like in the 2000 election. I mean, it's bizarre what you come up with, Mike. I don't know how you do it.
George,
know how you do it.
I want to thank you for calling, George, because I like sparring with you. I appreciate your comments about previous elections. We don't need to go back to that.
It's easy to. Yeah, I remember the comment. Get over it. Remember that comment?
Right. And you know what? I'm going to get over this one because I understand.
When will you get over this one, Mike?
No, I understand that the voters have made a decision. I understand.
They've rejected your philosophy.
I understand.
Hook, line, and sinker.
I understand that Barack Obama is going to be sworn in as the next president of the United States. I understand that we're going to have to deal with him for the next 4 years. I hope and pray for our country that he does not overreach. I hope and pray that he's successful. But the pragmatist in me tells me that he's not going to be reasonable. He's not going to be bipartisan.
Here's the interesting thing, George.
He's going to overreach. He's going to be very heavy-handed, and I'm going to oppose him when he's heavy-handed.
We have to take a break.
Rahm Emanuel is the first sign that he's going to be very heavy-handed, because that's all Rahm Emanuel is.
He's
the heaviest hand in the Congress.
I hope, George, you'll stay on the line after the break. But it seems to me striking that at a time when the voters have decisively rejected Mike Lane's views and his party's, he's still appealing to the same rejected. And I have to say, if he keeps this up, if he keeps appealing to these rejected philosophy, we will have a greater landslide in 2010 and 2012. Will the Republicans ever change? Will they go the route of Sarah Palin? Is that their new hero now? I want to talk about that with Mike, also with George and your calls. 888-488-MARK. Be right back.
I helped turn my child's public school into a whole new kind of school. One with a curriculum that really motivates kids. One that has extended hours, 6 days a week, year-round. With loads of academic, cultural, and recreational activities. One that has support services, like medical and dental, right there. A school where parents' involvement is encouraged, where teachers have more time to teach, and students are excited about learning. There's just one problem. My child doesn't ever want to come home. You can help turn your school into a community school for excellence. Find out how. Call 1-877-LOVE-TO-LEARN.
It's coming. Right to your neighborhood. when it does, you may be surprised. It's your Social Security statement of your benefits, and it's going to help you plan your financial future. Your benefit statement will tell you how much Social Security you're eligible to receive and when you'll get it. Then, you'll know how much you need to save for retirement, because that's coming too. The future is in your hands. Choose to save.
The toxic fumes from this meth lab are seeping into Jamie's sinus cavity. Ammonia vapors invade her throat. Toxic gases fill her lungs. Jamie's body is deteriorating. And she doesn't even know it.
Jamie, dinner.
So, who has a drug problem now? Find out how meth affects you at drugfree.org/meth.
Here again, The Inside Scoop with Mark Levine.
Welcome back to The Inside Scoop. It's an exciting time to be an American. People are cheering in the streets. People are excited about the prospects of a new, young, intelligent man, someone who's cool under pressure, taking over from the radicalness of the George Bush administration, someone who believes in open government rather than closed government. In fact, Barack Obama said today he's going to close Guantanamo Bay and allow all the prisoners there to have trials in the United States according to the Constitution, a subject that he once taught. Most Americans are happy. 59% are excited. 67% are proud. John McCain seems ready to move on. George Bush seems ready to move on. But there is a part of the Republican Party. There is a part that, David Brooks called it the rump of the Republican Party, that is still angry, that is still afraid. 27%, in fact, of Americans are afraid of Barack Obama. And maybe they're the ones that came out and cheered at the Palin rallies. Maybe I've got one sitting to the left of me. I'm not sure. His name is Mike Lane. He's a Republican strategist. And rather than being, I expected him to be magnanimous, to congratulate me, to say you won this one fair and square. He seems awfully angry. You're angry now, huh, Mike?
Mark, you did win this one fair and square. You did... assemble a coalition of perhaps lesser informed voters who went along with the program here.
What's interesting is the intellectuals of your party seem to have left your party and vote for Obama.
I don't minimize the historical nature of Senator Obama's victory. I wish him well. I hope that over the course of time he proves to be a good president. I don't trust him. I don't think he will prove to be a good president. When he does something right, I will come on your show and I will cheer for him. When he does something wrong, I will enthusiastically and cheerfully oppose him. I expect to lose on the majority of those opposition things because he is setting up an administration that's going to be a Democratic steamroller. He's got the majorities in the House and the Senate.
Right.
He doesn't need Republican votes. He's going to ignore Republican input.
We might need a few to stop a filibuster.
And he's going to steamroll Republicans in Congress.
Just to be clear, we have 57. Alaska, Minnesota, and Georgia are out.
And
it's unlikely we're going to win all three. We may not win any of them. We will probably need a Republican or two to prevent a filibuster, but I'm hopeful that Olympia Snow or Susan Collins or Arlen Specter come and help us out.
It's going to be set up as a steamroller over Republican ideas. There will be no opportunity in the House of Representatives for Republican alternative votes. There'll be no substitutes.
In other words, it'll be just the way it was when Republicans were in control.
But Nancy Pelosi promised it was going to be different, and Barack Obama promises things will be bipartisan, and they won't.
So here's what interests me, Mike. When the Republicans are in charge, when George...
I didn't defend Republicans on it.
In 2000, Al Gore wins a substantial majority of the popular vote, more than half a million.
He won by half the width of a hair.
He's the choice, half a million people.
Half the width of a hair.
He's the choice of most voters in Florida. He's the one who would win the electoral vote if it hadn't been for the court intervention. And at that moment, and also in 2004, when George Bush got the lowest re-election total of any president in American history, Karl Rove declared a mandate. He didn't care how close it was. We're in charge. We have a conservative nation for decades to come. We're not going to listen to any Democratic ideas. We hate bipartisanship. He said it. He ruled that way. and George Bush has just gotten, and his party have gotten thrown out on his ear. What's interesting to me is the Democrats, having won a substantial majority, frankly, better than Bill Clinton did, better than Ronald Reagan did in 1980 when he first came into office, more Democrats in the House, more Democrats in the Senate. He's saying he's going to work with Republicans. And what's interesting to me is you're saying if the Democrats treat the Republicans the way the Republicans treated the Democrats, that's grossly unfair. And it's just fascinating to watch you flip-flop. Like that.
Mark, first of all, let's go back to your first ridiculous comment, which was that Al Gore would have won had it not been for the courts. In fact, Al Gore went to court precisely because he wasn't winning.
George Bush went to court first to prevent
the stealing of the election.
To prevent them from counting the votes.
And the courts agreed that the election should not be stolen the way Al Gore was trying to do it. Now, let's talk about what the Republicans did and what the Democrats did.
They declared, they said that they could do whatever they wanted.
George Bush came to Washington very naively, and he thought he was going to be able to work with Democrats. He thought he could have a bipartisan administration the same way he had in Texas. He worked very well with Democrats down in Texas, and he extended the olive branch, and even during his inaugural address, he shook hands with the Speaker of the House then.
He shook their hands.
And said, let's work together. And before he could even walk back to the White House in the inaugural parade, the Democrats were shooting him in the back and turning it into the most partisan thing.
First of all, the Speaker of the House was a Republican.
George Bush learned through time that he couldn't work with the congressional Democrats because they were not interested in working with him. Come Barack Obama now, okay? He says he wants to be bipartisan. He doesn't want to be bipartisan. He wants to say it. He wants to create the illusion. But the single thing of appointing Rahm Emanuel as the chief of staff of the White House says spades about what he wants to do in terms of bipartisanship. To it, nothing. He wants to steamroll the Republicans. He wants to have Rahm Emanuel do what he does best, which is to whip the Democrats all into the same team, steamroll the Republicans. There will be no opportunity for offering of substitute motions to the Republicans the way Nancy Pelosi promised when she came to power. There will be no opportunities for Republicans to have input. There will be no bipartisan meetings at the White House where we all work it out. This is going to be a Democrat show, House, Senate, and White House, start to finish. And you know what? I don't blame him for doing it because he's got the power to do it. Why should he work with the Republicans? He's not going to. He's being disingenuous when he says he's going to. And he shouldn't.
First of all, Mike, it's an amazing rewrite of history because I was working in Congress right after September 11th. I was there when members of Congress of both parties stood together saying God bless America on the steps of the Capitol. I was there when we drafted the first version of the Patriot Act, a version I am very proud to say came out of the House Judiciary Committee unanimously. It's something that almost historians never talk about. Unanimous. Maxine Waters on the left to Lamar Smith on the right, we came to an incredible bipartisan agreement that protected civil liberties, still went after terrorists. The far left and the far right supported it, and George Bush took that perfect, unanimous bipartisan thing, threw it in the trash.
Because it wasn't enough to protect the American people.
Lamar Smith thought it was enough. Chairman Sensenbrenner thought it was enough.
No, Chairman Sensenbrenner supported the new one.
No.
Chairman Sensenbrenner supported all of the new ones.
Was rolled and you know
no, he supported the new ones.
Daryl Issa. All of the Republicans on the far right supported
Mark,
it, all
you know,
of them on the left.
You know,
so it's an amazing rewrite of history.
You know the power that chairmen have. They can stop anything from going there through their committee that they want. Yes, they can. A chairman can do that. Yes,
they can't. I can get Feingold was rolled by Jashel.
You don't even need to convene your committee.
It's not true.
Oh, how's the committee going to get convened if you don't convene it, if chairman?
The leader of a party can, in the House of Representatives, I assure you, Mike, I was there, can overrule a chairman. They can roll the chairman. It doesn't happen often, but it happened on the Patriot Act, and I was there.
Chairman Sensenbrenner supported the rewrite of the Patriot Act.
No, he didn't.
The Democrats did not.
He did not support the rewrite. It didn't go through the committee. You know that.
Let me ask you this.
The version that became law never went through committee. You understand that?
I understand
that. It was brought directly to the floor against Sensenbrenner's will. He was rolled.
Could the act that passed the Judiciary Committee...
I don't want to get too far afield.
Could it pass today? The answer is no, it couldn't. The Democrats would not support even the one they supported unanimously back in 2001.
There was a compromise, and the point is that George Bush hated compromise, refused compromise, ran this country to the radical right. Now, the American people have rejected this, and they have voted overwhelmingly They have voted overwhelmingly to give this country a new chance.
No, they have not voted overwhelmingly. Mark, they voted 52-47. This is not a landslide. This is a solid...
53-46.
This is a solid, impressive victory.
It is a landslide.
This is not a landslide.
It's a landslide.
No, it's no landslide. Come on.
The point is, the American people have made their decision.
I'm conceding President Obama...
It's just interesting to me that you're fighting this so hard. Rahm Emanuel is not working to whip Democrats anymore.
That's all he does.
He is the chief of staff.
He does not work with
Barack
Republicans.
Obama.
He has no relationship with...
That's not his job.
Yes, it is.
He is the chief of staff.
Okay.
No, the role of the chief of staff is to make sure that all the people working for the president are following the will of the president.
Mark.
It is his role to whip Democrats or the cabinet, if they include some Republicans, to make sure they are doing the president's will.
Whose job is it to call the Republican leader when there's something coming up and they say, oh, how are the Republicans going to do this? And the president says, why don't you call John Boehner and find out what the Republicans are going to do? Who does that? It's Rahm Emanuel who's going to do that.
It could be.
It's the chief of staff. That's his job.
Who's the current Republican chief of staff?
I doubt.
Who's George Bush's chief of staff?
I doubt. Hang on a second.
Tell me who it is.
I doubt very much that John Boehner will ever get a phone call from Rahm Emanuel, and if he does, he's not going to answer it.
Who is the current chief of staff?
I should know
this. I'm doing a test. It's Josh Bolton.
Josh Bolton, right. Former budget director.
Right. Now, Josh Bolton, a man who, when subpoenaed...
Very bipartisan
When it's subpoenaed by the House of Representatives, when he was held in contempt by the entire House of Representatives, said, I will not obey the law, I will not obey the Constitution. He said to Congress, F you. In the strongest possible terms, he said, I will go to jail rather than follow my constitutional responsibilities. That's Josh Bolton.
Mark,
now, he's
Mark,
not the face of George Bush.
The Constitution prevents the Congress from subpoenaing the personal staff of the president. It may not happen. It's called the separation of powers.
25 years of American history, not a single presidential advisor has ever disobeyed a subpoena of the legislature until this one.
And the legislature has no constitutional authority to subpoena the personal staff of the president.
Your view apparently differs from not only 225 years of constitutional scholars and courts, it also differs from the Republican judge appointed by George Bush who told Josh Bolton he had to obey that subpoena. My point is this. The Republicans have decided that they are going to run anti-Democrats as far as even going beyond the limits of the Constitution, and you're complaining about Rahm Emanuel. I find that amazing. Amazing.
I told you Emanuel is the right guy at the right time for the right job.
And I tell you, I just said that
it is proof positive that Barack Obama has no intention of working with Republicans. He's not going to be bipartisan. I wouldn't be bipartisan if I were him. He has an agenda he wants to ram through, and he's going to be successful for the most part in doing it.
Good. I hope so.
And to be To begrudge Republicans the opportunity to cheerfully cast a nay vote against the excesses
of the
Democratic monopoly.
They can cast all the nay votes they want.
I don't understand why you're against this.
They can cast all the nay votes they want. I'll tell you this. Republican Mel Martinez of Florida, senator, not someone seen as particularly moderate, also agreed that Rahm Emanuel was a perfect choice, someone who could get the job done for Barack Obama. But, some people are a lot angrier than others, and that's okay.
It's a time to say nice things.
It is a time to say nice things, and that's why it surprises me that you're not saying them.
Because I want to warn our audience that Rahm Emanuel is proof positive that Barack Obama does not want to be bipartisan.
You're attacking the man before he's even done anything, and that's what, you know what it tells me, Mike? Is that you are going to be the person that it doesn't matter what this president does. Barack Obama could bring world peace, a massive surplus, a tremendous economy, and you would be naysaying him because, he shared his toys in kindergarten.
No.
I mean, this is the kind of Republican Party.
If he brings world peace, a vibrant economy, I'll be on his team.
If you continue, and you and your party continue this way, I have to tell you, we're going to win even bigger in 2010, even bigger in 2012. The American people are tired of this.
They are tired of,
he pals around with terrorists. Oh, he's a Marxist. Oh, he's going to kill us all. Oh, his middle name's Hussein. Run, scared, hide.
I don't know anybody who has a problem with his middle name. Tell me three people who had a problem with his middle name.
I don't know anybody. There's a whole bunch of people on the right wing. I don't know one of them.
I listen to talk radio, Mark. In fact, I'm not going to have the right because Barack Obama is going to put talk radio out of business. He's going to...
Changing the subject. I support the fair doctrine. I want to ask you about... I want to ask you about the future of the Republican Party because I found it striking to me. And let's get rid of the break. We can go on. We'll go on right to the end. It strikes me that you had said that lesser informed voters voted for Obama. Mm-hmm. Here's what I find striking, Mike. If you look at the many, many Republicans that deserted the sinking McCain-Palin ship, and respectable Republicans, people like Chris Buckley, the son of William F. Buckley, the patron saint of conservatives who founded the National Review, or people like Colin Powell, very well-respected Republican, Joint Chiefs of Staff, served in the Bush administration, people like Kathleen Parker of the National Review, people like Susan Eisenhower. We see all these moderate Republicans jump ship and join the Obama team. And what they said is interesting. David Brooks is another one. They said, or I'll give you another one. Republican speechwriter, woman, Katie.
No. Wrote for Reagan.
Yes. Anyway,
I'll think of her.
I'll think of her name too. Anyway,
she writes for the Wall Street Journal
yes,
now.
Yes. All these conservatives are George Will. Even you find the intellectual conservatives, the educated in your party, were the ones most offended by Sarah Palin, the ones most upset with John McCain's tactics, the ones most likely to jump your party. The ones that are supporting Obama tend to be the more educated, the more intellectual in your party. What's fascinating to me is that the people who still support the Republican Party, the people who love Sarah Palin, tend to be the least educated, the most racist, the most radical, the people who are most likely to be fundamentalists who believe that, you know, dinosaurs walk the earth at the same time as man, as Palin believes. These are the ones that are, to me, it reminds me of Millard Fillmore's Know Nothing Party. Peggy Noonan is her name. Thank you very much, Peggy Noonan. If you find the respectable people are leaving your party, and I have to say, if the Republican Party continues down the Palin anti-intellectual path, you're going to become even more of a minority. Why is it that your party seems to be throwing away intellect and education and going for just base emotions?
All right, let's go through, you know, your cast of characters
right.
here. First of all, Colin Powell, a nice guy, very respected, good general, sort of mediocre Secretary of State.
A moderate Republican.
Never said he was a Republican.
Yes, he did.
No. Was asked.
He said it just a week ago.
Never.
He said it even since the election.
You know what?
Even since the election, he said, the Republican Party, my party, has to reform itself.
No.
He said that in the last few days.
All right. Well, that's the first time he's ever said he was a Republican.
No, he said it before.
Because I remember when he was.
He said it before they asked him if he'd run for president.
I remember asking. No, he didn't say it when he was thinking of running for president.
Yes, he did.
What he said was, I've looked at all the things, and I think on balance, I'm more comfortable with the Republican policies than I am with the Democrat. But he never said he was a Republican.
He said so.
Never did it.
What about the others? Buckley, Peggy Noonan.
Chris Buckley, a minor player in anything.
Peggy Noonan, Ronald Reagan's speechwriter.
Peggy Noonan, not a policy person, a speechwriter. Okay,
but someone who felt that the Republicans were turning her off.
No.
She said, if Palin, if the Republicans follow Palin, this kind of viciousness that there's
Peggy Noonan, a speechwriter, not a particularly influential character in the bigger scheme of things. David Brooks, never a solid Republican. Probably the single most.
You're throwing out all the moderates in your party.
David Brooks, never a solid Republican. You know, just David Brooks, occasionally a Republican.
George Will is a conservative.
George Will, don't understand the man. Just going to tell you, don't understand George
He's
Will.
He's an intellectual. That's
and,
the thing.
And let's talk about the one that you said that surprises me, because the one I hadn't heard of, and that's Kathleen
Parker.
National Review. Kathleen Parker doesn't. She writes for the Washington Times Syndicate, not for the National Review.
She's the one who writes in the Washington Post and the National Review. I thought it was Kathleen Parker.
She writes for the Times. Maybe you're talking about Cato Byrne?
No.
Because she writes for the National
the
Review.
The one who came out in the National Review, anti-Palin, received all the hate mail.
Okay, I didn't know about that one.
I thought that was Kathleen
Parker. I would be surprised if it was Kathleen Parker.
Here's my point. It seems to me that, well, first of all, let me ask you, do you think Sarah Palin is the future of your party?
I think she's part of the future of our party, and I think she's a great American.
You support her in 2012?
Great political leader. You know, Mark, there are a lot.
Because I do. I would love to see Sarah Palin get your nomination in 2012.
There are a lot of people.
She might be convicted first, but if she's not.
In fact, she was certified innocent the day before the election.
Oh, no, but there's more.
You might have missed it. She was certified innocent by the entire Democratic witch hunt investigation.
No.
Yes.
You're confusing.
Certified innocent by the entire Democratic witch hunt investigation.
You're confusing the people she hired with the Republican legislature. The Republican legislature said she abused her power and violated ethics law. The people she appointed, what do you know?
Certified
they
innocent.
They said she did okay.
Certified innocent.
Wow.
Now,
you know, Nixon's people, the people he appointed, also said he was okay.
Let's talk about where the Republican Party is
going. G. Gordon Liddy never said Nixon made a mistake.
All right, here's what we have. Sarah Palin is a great governor, a great leader, a great Republican.
But she's not very smart or well-informed.
You know what? She's particularly bright. In fact, she's,
really?
She's very, very bright.
Do you know how she feels about Africa?
Yes, in fact, I do.
Do you know that, for example, she didn't know that Africa was a continent and she thought it was a country?
Mark, you know, you're swallowing the same garbage that
all the Obama people are. No. This is great.
I can show you the website.
It came from a McCain source.
Right.
That when they were trying to teach her in the debates, not only did she misunderstand the basic differences between state, federal, and municipalities. Not only does she not know what a vice president's supposed to do, we can talk about that, but she didn't know that Africa was a continent and not a country. She didn't know. And they asked Sarah Palin directly, did you know whether Africa was a continent? And her response was not, of course I knew Africa was a continent. This is ridiculous. That was not her response.
Mark.
Her response was, who said that?
Mark.
And they said, well, these are unnamed sources. And she said, well, I won't dignify unnamed sources. And they said to her, well, did you know Africa was a continent? And she said, I'm not going to answer that question.
You know what? You're drinking the Kool-Aid, Mark.
I think most fifth graders know Africa as a continent. I know all of my listeners know Africa as a continent.
Give me a chance, Mark.
All right, go ahead.
Give me a chance.
Go ahead.
You're drinking the same Kool-Aid. There are these unnamed sources in the McCain campaign.
Sources.
Which, by the way, are no longer unnamed because MSNBC broke it wide open today.
Oh, who were they?
They came out and they announced it was none other than Michael Eisenstadt, senior policy advisor to John McCain, who said, you know what? You're exactly right. You know, if we're going to make these accusations, we have to be there. And he called up MSNBC, and they ran with it, and they were on the air for 3 hours talking about Michael Eisenstadt until, guess what? Other news organizations did the homework, and they found out there was no Michael Eisenstadt associated with the Obama campaign. MSNBC drank the Kool-Aid as well.
Why didn't Sarah Palin say, of course I know Africa's a continent?
I'll tell you how they're untrue, and I'll tell you how I know they're untrue.
Why didn't she respond?
I'll tell you, because you don't respond to drivel like this, and that's exactly what it is drivel.
Yes, you do. You say, of course I knew Africa was a continent. This is ridiculous. And then the story goes away if it's untrue.
We could look it up. If the computer was not down tonight, I would play for you her interview in the Miss Alaska pageant contest back in...
Africa was a continent then?
In her interview, she talked all about Africa and South Africa and the difference and what was necessary.
Really?
She was as articulate about Africa in her interview in the Miss Alaska contest. And Mark, that goes back, as you know, 24 years.
I will check that interview.
So,
but we're also finding out more. We're finding out that she spent far more than $150,000. It suggested double that amount.
McCain, I forgot her last name,
told her she could have 3 suits, and she went out on her own shopping spree, used lower-level staffers, used their cards. This is a woman, it's amazing to me that, I gotta tell you, I hope you do nominate her. There's nothing Democrats would like to see more than Obama versus Palin in 2012, because we only won, 30 states this time. We can win 45.
Here's the story. You know, the more you want to underestimate Sarah Palin, go ahead. You have a couple.
I hope you choose her. I'm all for her.
You have a couple.
Go Palin, go.
You have a couple bitter McCain staffers who had their White House offices already picked out in the West Wing, and now they're not going to get
it. No, they didn't.
And
they were realistic.
In part, because the problem was John McCain, as interesting and inspiring a story as he was not an inspiring or a particularly good candidate.
Now you attack him.
So
Throw him to the fire.
I voted for him, and I would vote for him again under the same circumstances.
Who should have run?
But
who should have run?
Hang on a second. What we had was a presidential candidate who would go out and attract 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 people to a presidential rally, and you had a vice presidential candidate who would go out and attract 20,000, 25,000, 30,000
more
to a vice presidential rally.
You know who attracted more? Joe McCarthy did. You know who attracted more than Joe McCarthy?
No.
Huey Long. You know, it's amazing. Democrats can get a very large group of people.
And you know who attracted even more than that? Barack Obama. So you're right. Demagogues can get a big thing.
What we have here is,
let's look at the future, okay? What you're going to see is probably five or six people are going to accept Palin's hate fest.
A few will.
You're going to, please. The reason you are so worried about Palin
is because I would love to see her be president.
Why are we spending 10 minutes talking about Sarah Palin if she's not important?
Because I want to know if she's the future of your party or not.
Because you're scared of Sarah Palin.
Would you like to see her as a nominee? Would you like to see her as a nominee?
I haven't decided where I'm going yet, but I'll tell you where the party's going, okay? Right now, based on name identification, she's the choice of 64% of the Republicans.
Republicans?
People.
Terrific. Right. I hope
but
she gets it.
That's based on name ID. You
I
know
hope
that.
She gets it.
You know that, and I know that. That's based on name ID at this
she
point.
She may be convicted for it. I'm a little worried about
I'll
that.
I'll tell you who we're going to be. The Republicans are going to have a choice between Michael Steele, Sarah Palin, Bobby
Jindal
down in Louisiana. This is the future of the Republican Party. We are going to diversify. We are going to
Michael Steele is much of a crook as Sarah Palin. I hope they choose
him. We are going to carry our message of individual responsibility and reliability out to people who will hear it. They will be much, much better
Individual responsibility.
Much better messengers than were either George Bush or John McCain on that particular thing. And that's where we're going to rebound.
Is that the message of the Republican Party, individual responsibility?
No. It has been historically the message of the Republican
Party. Is that what it
Party.
Should be?
That's what it should
Tell
be.
Tell me this. What part of the bailout do you think shows individual responsibility? The part where they bailed out AIG, the part where they bailed out Bear Stearns, the part where they're bailing out the banks? Which part do you think shows individual responsibility? These are Republican plans.
You're right. And they go contrary to the philosophy of the Republican
I
Party?
I think so.
And let me tell you where I think the Republican Party should be, okay, on that? We should preserve markets. We should not preserve companies. There was a real danger in the overall bailout of the financial markets themselves collapsing. Whatever we needed to do to preserve those markets was the right thing to do. When you take it a step further and you start preserving individual companies like Bear Stearns, big mistake, should never have happened, disavow it right now. AIG, there can be an argument made. I'm not convinced.
They're
but there's
giving
an argument.
More now, even more.
Yeah, you know what?
Another $100 billion where the $84 billion went. It still may fail.
I think it's bad money after bad.
I agree with you.
I think it should stop.
Wait a minute, I agree with you.
I think that.
Don't we have to stop this show now? I agree with you.
I think that the Obama plan to bail out the car companies is a very bad thing.
That's not an Obama plan.
You can. Yeah, that's an Obama.
Right now, it's a Pelosi plan.
It's an Obama plan.
Has Obama announced?
He's endorsed it. He says that's one of the first things he wants done is the bailout of the automotive. Companies.
Here's my view on the auto companies.
Here's what we need to do, okay? Preserve markets, don't bail out companies. That would be the key to a real economic recovery. Mark, we have 10 car companies, 7 of which are doing well. It's only the ones in Detroit which are not doing well.
You're talking about the Japanese car companies?
No, I'm talking about Honda.
Toyota.
I'm talking about Honda USA, Toyota USA.
Okay. The Japanese companies
Lexus
are doing
USA,
well.
Nissan USA, they're all doing fantastic.
And you know why the Japanese companies are doing well and the American companies are doing bad?
Because they have good management.
Because they make good cars.
And
you know why,
right.
they make good cars? Because they make the cars for the future. Because the Japanese companies understood what Detroit didn't. That it's actually good to have green cars. It's good to have hybrids. It's good to have cars that aren't gas
guzzlers. So let the Detroit
it's
companies
good
go
that
away.
It's good that are good for the environment. And it's amazing to me that when the American companies do so bad, it's always Republicans saying, support these American companies. They don't need CAFE standards.
No, we don't
they
need
do.
To, no, they,
Apparently,
no, they don't. Let them go away.
Detroit doesn't
Why do we need
know
to preserve
to the right thing.
Look,
I don't want to preserve the management at all.
Companies have the right to fail. If GM has failed, let it go away. Come on.
I'll tell you something. As long as the Japanese companies can buy these companies, in other words, if Honda can buy what's left and make sure those GM workers still have a job, we don't end up with 100,000 unemployed, I'm okay with that because I think they make better choices. If the American companies stick around and if we give them a bailout, which I think should be a loan, not a payment, I would insist that they follow practices that are good for the country. If they take our money, they have to do things that are good for the country, and the first thing they need is high gas mileage. Mike, I want to make a comment at the end. So I only got
give
a few
me, give me 10 seconds.
10 seconds, go ahead.
The last thing is, on the bailout, there is no transparency. The Treasury and the Fed are hiding what they're doing. That has to stop.
I agree, and Obama, I think, agrees too. You're going to find a lot more transparency.
I doubt it.
Let me say this in the last minute. One of the greatest things, of course, that happened on Election Day was we had African Americans turn out in number. We had white Americans turn out in number. Race actually was not an issue. Race, if anything, helped Barack Obama. And this, to me, is vindication of all those on the left who put America down and said, no, we can't do that. We can't elect a black president. Plenty of blacks said, we can't elect a black president. I am proud to say that all of you are wrong. I am proud to say that those of you on the left that said, no, we can't, yes, we can. But I also have a message for those that would vote for Barack Obama, African Americans in California, and yet voted to deny gay people civil rights. My message is that they need to watch and make sure they deny civil rights to no one. Remember that message. Mark Levine.